Hi, it's Matt Karamazov. Welcome back to the channel. And if you're new here, it's good to have you. I hope you'll stick around. So I'm doing something a little tiny bit different this month. I've done plenty of book haul videos where I talk about the books that I just bought at the bookstore or what have you. But this is my first time doing like a monthly reading recap. So we're going to go over everything that I finished in May, which was a pretty decent reading month, all things considered. As far as page count goes, I finished 3,717 pages, which was 48% of my reading goal. So less than 50%, obviously, but you know, nearly 4,000 pages. So I don't think that's too bad. That also worked out to 13 books, which I finished. Five of them were physical books, the rest of them were on my phone. So we're gonna get into exactly what those were, and we're starting right now. Okay, so the first book that I finished in May was Faust by Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, one of the masterpieces of world literature, and one of my favorite books now. It was really, really good. I actually read the whole thing out loud. And I won't give like a big summary of all the books, but just a few words about this one. So it's a retelling of a really old medieval legend. And so there's a doctor, Faust, and he's dissatisfied with life. He's older. Now what he says in the very beginning, he says, "I have alas studied philosophy, jurisprudence, and medicine too. And worst of all, theology, with keen endeavor through and through. And here I am for all my lore, the wretched fool I was before." So he's reached like the end of knowledge basically, and he's old, he doesn't really enjoy being alive anymore, and he's just about to off himself, and the devil appears to him in the form of a black poodle, and don't ask, and he makes a bet with Faust, saying that he can show Faust that he can create a moment so great that Faust will want to live it, and or like not want to end his life anymore. And Faust doesn't think that that's possible, so he takes the bet, and spoiler alert, Faust ends up losing. But, and this is what makes Goethe like such a spectacular human being, basically. You know, Faust is saved anyway, so even though he lost the bet with this devil and he owes his soul, he's saved in the end, because as far as Goethe's concerned, there's no, you know, in his cosmology, there's no sight of eternal damnation. So, like, any god that's worth talking about would never punish someone eternally. And that's what Goethe believes, and that's why he saves Faust at the end. It's really, really, really good book. Anyway, so really good. So the next book, and I'll go a little bit faster, is The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn by Mark Twain, or Samuel Clemens, for those who know him well. And this is sort of an embarrassing admission, and I almost didn't even want to bring this up. But for the longest time, I thought that The Adventures of Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn were the same book. But apparently it's The Adventures of Tom Sawyer and then The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, two totally different books. I had no idea. I don't even care to admit that. But it's a really, really good book. So Huck Finn, it's like his moral evolution, his sort of coming to consciousness. And so he's traveling down the Mississippi River. He's sort of running away from home, basically. And he travels with this escaped slave named Jim. And he sort of wrestles with his conscience, basically. Like, do I turn this guy in or do I not? And he honestly believes, or he's taught to believe, that it's wrong to turn in, or it's wrong not to turn in this escaped slave to the authorities. And he believes that he's, again, with the damnation, he believes that he's going to hell if he doesn't turn in the slave. But he says that, you know, like, man, Jim is my friend. I'm not going to turn him in. So, but it's wrong not to, and he sort of wrestles with that. And he comes to the conclusion that I don't care what happens to me. Jim is my friend. I'm not going to turn him in, and we're going to escape together. And it's just, man, it's really, really, really good book. Again, really, really good. The next one was A Deepness in the Sky by Werner Vinge. That was one that I read on my phone. 970 pages on my phone. yeah, which is a lot of just staring at screens. But it's science fiction, and basically like a space opera, basically. It's like panoramic novel, basically. It's like War and Peace in space. Again, I won't dive into like a big summary, but it's decently good. If you like science fiction, you more than likely will enjoy it. If you're not so into science fiction, don't start with this, you know, 1,000-page giant of a book. But there's it's like, A Deepness in the Sky was the prequel, or like a loose prequel to A Fire Upon the Deep, which I guess I have to read now, because I did enjoy A Deepness in the Sky enough to read this, like the next thing. But then that ropes me into like 1,500 pages. Anyway, it was good, but don't start with that if you don't really like science fiction. Next was, what was it? It was Stillness Speaks by Eckhart Tolle. So he was the author of The Power of Now, which, fun fact, was the second book that I ever finished ever since I started counting. So like back in 2014. I'm up at 976 right now. Just a few hours ago, I finished Modern Man in Search of a Soul by Carl Jung. That was number 976. The Power of Now was number 2. Anyway, Stillness Speaks, much along the same lines of The Power of Now, presence, stillness, peace, and mindfulness, and it is really, really good. And it's more aphoristic than anything else, like snappy sort of sentences that just catch you off guard in the best possible way. So that was pretty cool. And then the next book was A History of Reading by Alberto Manguel, which is this one right here, and I picked it up at my local bookstore, which you should definitely do if you get the chance. It's exactly what it says. I mean, it's you can judge this book by its cover. It's a history of reading, and it's really, really good. And it's even more so because of the sort of personal flavor that that Manguel brings to it. And he's lived like a pretty long and like, interesting life. So he has I forget whether he just lived there or was born in Brazil, or I forget exactly where, somewhere in South America. But anyway, he was working in this bookstore as a young child, or as a young kid, like a teenager or whatever. And the writer, Borges, Jorge Luis Borges, he comes into the bookstore. And if you know Borges, he was blind. Ever since he lost his sight, he had to get people to read to him. And he actually asked this guy, when he was a teenager, to read to him. So this guy, as a teenager, read out loud to the blind Borges, who was basically a legend in the history of the written word. Anyway, there are all these sort of connections, and it's exactly what it sounds like, a history of reading, where it developed and how, who tried to stop reading. Obviously, there's a whole chapter on forbidden reading, so people trying to keep literacy away from slaves, and, you know, the Nazis burning books in the 30s and stuff like that. And actually, there's a really good picture in here. It's worth trying to find. Let's see. Ah, here it is. It's giant, so I knew I'd find it really quickly. It is basically like a bombed out library from World War II. And this is an actual photo. You can see here that, there are, like, the roof is totally caved in, and there are people still going in for, you know, going in for books, which is super cool. And it's full of amazing photos like that, and just really cool stories. So if you're interested at all in, like, the history of reading, again, it's exactly what it sounds like, is definitely a good choice. So the next book was A Matter of Death and Life by Irvin and Marilyn Guillaume. Again, really, really good. I don't read shitty books, so basically every book on this list I enjoyed. Because as a rule, I don't really finish it. In the rare case, I'll finish it if I'm not enjoying it. But if I finish a book and talk about it later in one of these videos, it's because I actually really enjoyed it. Irvin Guillaume, he was like, he's basically one of the giants of existential psychology or psychotherapy. And he actually had a book of that name that came out in 1980, I think. So it's him and people like Rollo May, people like that who basically, you know, spend their entire careers thinking about, the subconscious fear of death and meaning in life and how people actually live authentically in the face of, you know, of knowing that they're not going to live forever and that, you know, the people that they love aren't going to live forever. And that's exactly what A Matter of Death and Life is about, actually. And it's co-written by him and his wife. And so she was just diagnosed with cancer. She was a writer as well, Marilyn. And so what they did was they went chapter by chapter. So he would write one, she would write one, he would write one. And then towards the end, they started writing like as soon as she got sick. And so towards the end, she's like too sick to write anymore. So it's just him and sort of dealing with like the death of his wife. And man, they were together for like, they were married for 65 years and in love for 73. So like they spent their entire lives together, and this is like their final book together. Super sad. Anyways, what else? So Demian was the next one. Nobel Prize winner, Hermann Hesse. And it's, again, it's like a Bildungsroman, is what they're called. It's like a coming of age novel. It's super short. You can read it in an afternoon. And so Emile Sinclair, is the main character. Basically, it's exactly what I just said, like his coming to consciousness and his mentor, Max Demian. And yeah, his sort of journey inward, I guess you could call it, sort of trying to to find out what he actually wants and what he actually, who he actually is, and not who everyone else tries to make him into or sort of leads him to believe that he is. It's like a in some place that he can only go alone, and sort of this Demian guy, he sort of shows him that, but then he sort of releases him and he has to go the rest of the way himself, as we all do. So, really, really good book. And then what's next? It was A Time for the Stars by Robert Heinlein. That was the next one. And it was super quick. As you might know, Heinlein wrote Stranger in a Strange Land, which was, again, one of my favorite books of all time, science fiction, and Starship Troopers. I've never read the book, but, I've seen the movie and I plan to read the book. Time for the Stars is like the kids' version of that. So, I mean, if you know both of those books, it's like a little bit heavy and like more intense. Starship Troopers more so than Stranger in a Strange Land. But Time for the Stars is basically these two young brothers who discover that they can communicate telepathically. And the story is that like Earth's becoming overcrowded, and they have to search for like other habitable planets. But the problem with communications is like as you approach the speed of light, it takes longer and longer for your messages to to be sent and received. And then it's discovered that the telepathic pairs can speak to each other or understand each other simultaneously, and it's not affected by time or distance. So they can be like the other edge of the universe looking for habitable planets, and they can talk to each other, where like that's the only form of communication along such huge interstellar distances. So it's a space adventure, but it's like super short and really easy to read. So it's not like it's nothing too heavy. I mean, there's some aliens and some like death and destruction, but very minimal as far as Heinlein is concerned. So Time for the Stars was pretty good. The next book after that was The Invention of Sound, I believe, which is, man, so it was Chuck Palahniuk's next book, or his latest book. I just found out that he wrote it, and instantly, like sight unseen, I just bought it, because anytime he comes out with a new book, Palahniuk, the author of Fight Club, I'll buy it. So, I loved that one, Invisible Monsters. I just finished in April, I think. Loved that one. I was like, sight unseen. I don't care what it's about. Palahniuk wrote it. It's his latest one. I want it. I was not disappointed. It's gory, I guess. Not particularly happy, but you don't go to Palahniuk for like happy stories. It's about this one guy, Gates Foster, who's searching for his daughter who disappeared 17 years ago, and so he's searching for her, and like whole big story there. And this other woman, Misty Eves, and her job is to create or to record the screams that they use in Hollywood horror movies, and her method of recording these screams to get them as realistic as possible is exactly what you would expect from a Palahniuk story. I'll leave it at that. Anyway, really good. And it's basically the commodification of death and violence in Hollywood and the wider society. Anyways, really, really good. After that, it was like the complete opposite, Madame Bovary. So, I mean, again, there's some death in this one. A little bit of a spoiler, well, a big spoiler. I mean, she offs herself in the end. She ends up, taking poison and killing herself. But it's a lot light. I mean, this came out in 1852, so it's not. You place this side by side with Palahniuk's, transgressive fiction, which is like the genre that he created for himself. Madame Bovary sounds pretty tame, but I enjoyed this a lot more than I actually thought that I would. I mean, I finished it, which is, again, like I said, it's the criterion of whether or not like I'm enjoying a book is I finish it, definitely. And one of the things about Flaubert is and this is said just about him generally, when he was like, his writing style is like he takes so much care and attention. He just provides so much attention to every single sentence that comes out of him, and basically he works all of his novels line by line and just making them absolutely perfect. And you definitely see the result of that. He's like a brilliant novelist, and this is the result of him taking extreme care with every single sentence. So it's really, really good. What's next? So two more books. The Lathe of Heaven by Ursula K. Le Guin. She is one of my favorite science fiction writers now. I'm actually reading a book about writing by her right now. It's called Steering the Craft. It's pretty good. And then the first one I read by her was No Time to Spare. It was a collection of essays. But this one is the first of her novels that I read. And it's basically about, again, I'm not going to give like too much away or do too much of a, like a summary or anything, but this, the main character, George Orr, which some people think is a reference to George Orwell, who knows? Anyway, so he discovers that his dreams can change reality or change the past. So like he will dream something, and then when he wakes up, the entire history of the world has switched around to reflect the reality of his dream. So the story, and this happens in the very beginning, the therapist that he goes to help him, you know, stop dreaming like this, tries to take advantage of his dreams and change the world according to what the doctor wants to have happen. And it's almost like a genie in a lamp type thing. Like he asks for something from his dream, and it's like the literal interpretation. Anyway, it's a fantastic, really good book. And just like, this isn't about like the plot or anything, but the very first part of Ursula's book on writing is all about how writing sounds, or how your writing should sound when you speak it out loud. So I mentioned how I read Faust out loud, and she places special attention on how your writing sounds when spoken. And when you do that with her own writing, you see exactly what she's talking about. So the very first part of Lathe of Heaven, you read that out loud, it is beautiful. It's like really worth reading out loud. Anyway, so I won't give any more to that. I want to get to this last book here, and it's Chesterton. So The Man Who Knew Too Much by Chesterton. I was underwhelmed by this one, but I absolutely... Okay, so the first Chesterton book that I ever read was The Man Who Was Thursday. And The Man Who Was Thursday is one of my absolute favorite books of all time, bar none, and I knew nothing about Chesterton going into it. So I was completely and totally surprised by this. I was like floored by how good The Man Who Was Thursday was. And so I immediately, I've heard of The Man Who Knew Too Much. So I was like, my expectations were sort of elevated a little bit. So I wanted to really, really, really like it. Instead, I just sort of liked it quite a bit. Again, spoiler alert, but I mentioned this because the last line of the book, it's divided into 8 stories, and they're like detective stories. So the main character, Horne Fisher, is the man who knew too much, and he dies in the end. That's the spoiler. But anyway, so the last lines of the book, where he's laying out dead, he says, or Chesterton says, that the man who knew too much finally knew what was worth knowing, which is like an amazing end to a book. And that is the end of the books that I've read in May. Okay, so I'm gonna wrap this up, but just a few more things. So first off, next month, or like this month, June, I am so close, I'm gonna make it. I'm going to have read 1,000 books by the end of this month. So like I mentioned before, like I started counting years ago, the first book that I finished when I started counting was Crime and Punishment by Dostoevsky, and that was in 2014. So from then until now, I've read 976 books. And this month, and like I chose short books for this purpose. I want to finish it this month. I want to have read 1,000 books. So I'm going to do it this month. But June's going to be really busy. I've got a lot of stuff going on. So 9,000 pages is going to be like a really big challenge. And I've read less than I needed to in the last couple of days. You know, like I'm already behind. So we'll see how that goes. But I'm re-recording my online course called Reading Mastery. It's basically everything I know about how to read more books and learn faster and stuff like that. So I'm re-recording that. I hope to have that out by the end of the month. And then I've got other writing responsibilities and YouTube videos and stuff like that. So I got plenty on the go. I even have a court date later on this month. I'm not on trial this time, but yeah, it's like somebody I have to like testify against. So I mean, if you don't hear from me, it went really badly. But maybe I can bring like a book or something to the courthouse with me and get some reading done there. It won't be like a total waste of a reading day. But anyway, so I've got tons of other boring goals I won't bore you with. But lots of stuff going on. I hope to have, you know, maybe 1,000 subscribers to the channel. I don't know when that'll happen, hopefully before the end of the summer. And I'll mention now, like for every new subscriber to the channel, what I do is I donate $1 to the children's charity First Book. And what they do is they give books to kids who otherwise wouldn't be able to afford them or have access to them. So I love doing that. So if you want to stick around for that, it's a free, easy way to support the channel. And I also fundraise for Doctors Without Borders, the global humanitarian relief organization. So I've got a fundraising page down there below. And basically, and also, like all my notes just in case you haven't heard this before, all my notes for every single book that I've ever read are on my Patreon, so down below. And my Patreon members get the reading course for free. So a whole bunch of stuff like that, and yeah. And actually, more stuff for free. Every single month, I pick one of my email subscribers at random, and I buy them a book of their choice. So all you have to do is be on my email list. You can find that down in the video description. And so every single month I pick a winner and I buy them a book of their choice. So again, these are all like easy, free ways to support the channel, read more books, just get more, you know, free bookish stuff, and really help out with some good causes too. So First Book and Doctors Without Borders, and there's a few others that I like to support. I give monthly to Charity Water, which supplies, you know, water throughout the world, a whole bunch of stuff like that. Basically, one of the things that I learned, you know, early on, like the best way to spend money, like how you buy happiness, is to spend it making other people's lives better. Like, it always works every single time. Every time I spend money on myself, sure, it's fun. Like, I spend money on myself all the time, but, you know, after a certain amount of time, it's like, it's boring. You know, you feel like Faust after a while, right? But, you know, spending money on someone else and making someone else's life better, like, that works every single time. That will make you happier every single time. It just works. So whenever you can help somebody out, do it. Like, it's never a waste of time. And as always, I'll leave you with the words of Frederick Douglass. He was an escaped slave, and he taught himself how to read. And he taught himself how to read so well that he became one of the best writers ever, basically. And what he said is that once you learn to read, you will be forever free. I couldn't agree more, so go read a book, and I will see you on the next video. Cheers. I don't waste time, no, I make time. All these people wanna hate, fine, I'ma make mine. While you sitting there complaining, I'll be training. While you sitting there just waiting, I'm creating. Yeah. Sometimes I think that I'm unstoppable. Yeah. Ready to go, man, lock and load.